Coming up on Heart of Worship Church.
What I hope the church was founded on remains for the next generation till Christ returns. My father started his church in 66 on the basis of holiness. And I hope it stays on holiness. I could have turned this church over to people that didn't preach holiness. They were here, they wanted it, but I wouldn't do it. I'd rather see it close than go to a denomination that didn't believe in holiness and preach holiness.
The Lord bless you.
Welcome. Thank you for joining us today. To learn more about our ministry, please visit us online at heartofworshipchurch.com.
Amen. Amen.
The sermon I'm going to preach today, I've already preached it in parts, but I took parts and I put them all together into one sermon. As senior pastor, I was here, I'll put it to you this way, I was here before the church was here. So I guess I'm senior pastor. I feel part of my job as senior pastor. It's to keep us on track. It's to keep us in one direction. Now, we can vary, but we don't want to vary from salvation. We don't want to vary from the virgin birth, the crucifixion, Passover, Easter, or whatever, however you want to call it. Call it however you want to call it. Some of us call it the Passover and Passover Sunday, whatever. I still call it Easter because that's how I was raised, calling it Easter. We don't want to vary from that. And we want to stay holiness. I'm a firm believer that if we do not have holiness, you're just like any other church around. No matter where you go, you can go anywhere. It's just the same thing. What sets us apart is holiness. Amen. Now, I'm one that believes you could actually live a holy life. Don't we teach that grace gives us the power to live above willful sin?
Amen.
Don't we teach that, and the Bible tells us that God will show us a way out. You know, he'll give us the opportunity to escape sin.
Yes. Yes.
All we have to do is take it. So that's some of the basics that I firmly believe in. That is how I was raised. I was raised Methodist Protestant. I was ordained Methodist Protestant. And the reason I'm making an extension or a difference is because most of your Methodists has strayed through the years. And the way it started was that they agreed to allow for the preachers or the pastors to drink, not get drunk, but drink sociably. That's how it all got started. So they started allowing the pastors to drink. Well, the next thing you know, they started ordaining homosexuals. for the Methodist Protestants stuck to the old John Wesley holiness. We didn't go down that route. So I do believe in holiness. I really do. God Himself says, "Be ye holy, for I am holy." So if you're worshiping anything other than a holy God, you're not worshiping God. If you're a church that says, "Oh, you just can't live holy," now understand that we view holiness as living right, but living separate from sin. So, and all this ramp that I'm doing right now has nothing to do with my sermon. I heard a few of us make the remark the last few weeks, and a lot of my sermons come from what the remarks y'all make. So watch what y'all say. Some of us says, "Oh, we don't believe in the rapture." And we actually don't believe in the rapture. But we do believe in the catching up. And it is a true event. It's going to take place. We do differ from most churches that we don't believe the catching up is in the beginning. We believe it's in the end. And let me say this again. We do not dictate, because we do have some people that believe in the pre-trib rapture. And we don't want to shun them. We don't want to run them off. We want to give them time to understand where we're coming from. And so the only thing, if I say we dictate what I said, we believe in holiness. We expect that you live a holy life. And when we started with these decals on our trucks, decals, whatever you call them, the first rule that I put out, if you put a heart of worship emblem on your vehicle, it does not go to the casino. Well, I don't know if the message what the message the good Lord gave me back, but only me and Danny got one.
Point taken.
So, but anyway, I want to kind of clear up how we should be thinking. If you believe in the pre-trib rapture, I'm not going to say it's fine with me, but I can live with you. I still love you. And I'll give you grace, like the good Lord gave me grace, that you'll come around and see the truth. And I'm going to show you in Scripture the truth. In Scripture, what the Bible actually says. And the main thing is Christ Himself says it. And who could deny Christ? I'm going to start this message out with a warning. A warning. Let's go to Revelation 22. Revelation 22, verse 18 and 19. Read those two verses, Danny.
"For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, and out of the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book."
Now, the reason I'm starting with this warning is because doctrines are formed out of stuff that's not in the Bible. The word rapture is not in the Bible. And this warning is telling you what's going to happen to you. And a whole doctrine has been formulated, the Left Behind series. And we all know the teachings that has come from the word rapture. And it's just not this one. This is just one of them. Once saved, always saved. Oh, I'm stepping on some toes down. Once saved, always saved. Is it in the Bible? No. But a whole doctrine, denomination has been formed on stuff that's not in the Bible. And that's why this warning is given, that we are not to add or take away. And we need to be cautious of that. I believe in what the Bible says. I understand where the word rapture came from. It's just another way of saying snatching up, or it's the Greek or whatever it is. But we need to be careful, because we've done away with the actual word of the Bible and replaced it with something that don't exist. And it's dangerous. We need to be careful for that. I'm like these judges. You know, these judges, that these federal judges that look at the law according to the way it was written in the 1700s or whatever it is. That's how I look at the Bible. I look at the Bible according to the way it was written then, not now. Because actually, I use three different Bibles to do my studying. I use the 1611 Geneva Bible, which is our original Protestant Bible. I use the 1611 Catholic Bible, and then I use my Bible here, which is the King James translation that's not, as far as I can tell, hasn't been changed, hardly any at all, which is why I stick to it. So I used three different Bibles to study. I don't use the computer as much as I used to, because I got to where I don't trust the computer. I used to tell the church, don't go to History Channel for your Bible lessons, because I'd have people come and quote stuff to me and tell me stuff. I said, where you get that from? They said, the History Channel. I said, well, don't go to History Channel. I said, the History Channel teaches that we all come from apes, and we know that's a lie. So don't go to History Channel. I'm tell you the same thing. Go with extreme caution to the computer, because it's too many too many ideas that's not biblically backed. Let's go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Y'all got it? Say oh man or amen.
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 Let's go to verse 13. Now, Paul was talking to this church, and he was telling them to not be hopeless, to have hope. You see, the Sadducees, and that's how I remember Sad, you see, did not believe in the resurrection. They did not believe in the afterlife. And the Pharisees, like Nicodemus, they believed in the afterlife. But and some of these people was teaching that there wasn't no afterlife. And Paul was trying to get them to, this church to understand that there is an afterlife. And if you believe that Christ rose, you should believe it too, you know. And verse 13, it says, but I would not have you be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. So Paul was telling them to have hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them God brings with him. Now, this is one what I want to caution, because I kind of picked this up with some of y'all. This resurrection is for everybody. It's not just for the tribulation saints. The tribulation saints will be raptured or caught up, but everybody's going to be caught up. It's nobody's going to be left out. It says, for if we believe. So I'm going to ask you, do you believe? Church, do you believe?
Amen.
If we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus. If you died as a Christian, will God bring with him. So it's everybody. Everybody from Adam and Eve to whatever the catching up comes. It's everybody that's going to be risen. My daddy used to tell me one day I'd be cutting that grass. And he said, the graves are going to start busting up. He said, if you bomb my grave, you're going to see me rise. Amen. He said, if you're living right, you might rise after me. He said, but you got to be living right. My daddy didn't know I was going to surrender to preacher unless God revealed it to him. My uncle did ask him who was going to take the church over. He said, y'all, when he was in the hospital dying, he said, y'all going to be surprised who's going to take the church over. So I want to bring home this. This is not just tribulation saints or people that's been martyred going to be caught up. It's everybody. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of an archangel, and with the trump, underline trump. That's not Donald Trump. Now, that's the horn trump. I even heard some preachers say that Trump was the real Trump. Yeah, but that ain't Donald Trump. Sorry to break some hearts. With an archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. So he's telling us that the dead that died as children of God is going to rise first. That means everybody, not just a few. Then when we which are alive and remain shall, now this is the key word, underline, caught up. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up. This is, and I'm in the habit of saying rapture too because we just said it so much. But I'm trying to retrain myself to say caught up because that's what the Bible says. Why don't we use the word that the Bible says? Why have we been brainwashed to use terminology, Bible theologies, or whatever you call, that don't even exist in the Bible? So we do believe that Christ is going to return, and we're all going to get caught up, the dead in Christ first, and then the ones that remain, we don't know, we say us, but because we feel that we're that close. But even though it's 100 years from now, then they will be caught up together with him in the cloud to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we even be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another. So Paul was trying to encourage his people to comfort one another and to be encouraged that if you believe that Christ rose, you're going to rise too. And so I'm encouraging y'all to start changing the name rapture to caught up because that's what the Bible says. And I'm encouraging you to never use the word once saved, always saved. Because that ain't gonna happen. If you are go back into sin, willful sin. Now a lot of people don't understand the difference in willful sin, and sin unto death. There's a sin unto death, John said, and one that's not. The sin unto death is the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. Now, let's go to Matthew 24. And some of these stuff I had preached. Danny, he got a phone call from his sister a few months back wanting to find out. I think she had asked him about the rapture situation. And at the same time, the good Lord was giving me this message. And God was dealing. I was asking God, look, I want to teach these people an easy way to understand Revelation. Revelation is really an easy book to understand. And that's when God gave me the message on the seven. Seven churches, seven seals, seven trumps, seven bowls or vials. It's just that simple. That's all there is to Revelation. Everything in between the great whore, the judgment, all that, that's it's fill-ins. But that is the key to Revelation. It's the number seven. The number seven means completion. So we are in the completion phase. It's coming over with. But God, when God was dealing with me in my sleep, I was fighting with gout. And I was thinking of Jacob in my sleep. Was it Jacob that fought with the angels? I was fighting with the angels, and he kept driving home immediately. Let's look at verse 24. No, not 24. Let's look at verse 29. And in my sleep, he kept driving home immediately. And take one note to this. Who is saying this?
Jesus.
Jesus himself. So when you deny this teaching right here, and you say there's another teaching, you're calling Christ a liar. I think you're blaspheming, really, is what you're doing. It's very dangerous. Again, I go back to that warning. He warned us, do not change. Do not change the periods and the commas. Do not change the Bible. So it tells you right here in verse 29 of chapter 24, and this is Christ himself says, immediately after tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven. And the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. What you're seeing is the return of Christ. And then shall appear the signs of the Son of Man in heaven. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn. And they shall see the Son of Man coming down in a cloud of heaven in power and glory. So Christ himself is saying what? Immediately after tribulation. Amen. He's not saying 7 years. I had to confess a couple of Sundays ago, Miranda was right. That kills me to say that because I know she's already needs a wheelbarrow to pack her head around. There is no 7 years mentioned in the Bible. It mentions the last three and a half. So I got to thinking, well, if there's no 7 years mentioned, we in America, we don't feel we in tribulation. But what about all these other countries that we've been reading every Sunday morning in Sunday school? Are they in tribulation?
Yeah.
I think they're in tribulation. They're being killed for being a Christian.
That's right.
They're being tortured for being a Christian. They're being jailed for being a Christian. We're just being blessed to be in America.
Amen.
But we're fast losing our grace with God.
Yeah.
We're losing it. We really are. So, and then shall appear the signs of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall, the earth mourn, and then they shall see the Son of Man coming in a cloud of heaven with power and great. Now, if you stop and think about it, he's describing the events in chapter 4, 1 Thessalonians. It's the same thing.
Yeah.
He's describing the catching up is what he's describing right here. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a bugle. Just catching y'all. Of a trumpet. And they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from the ends of heaven to the other. Now, who's his elect? The Jews. Jews are the elect from the Old Testament. And in the New Testament, we are the elect. We're grafted in. So now this is Christ himself. So, you know, years ago when I was studying this, and I never was one that believed in the pre-trib rapture, because my daddy never believed in it. He never taught it. Actually, the first time I would have done a revival in another state, and I was preaching what I was raised, I was attacked. You know, one of the little ladies come running up, "Brother Bayou, I have you to know that God's not going to put us through this." I said, "What makes us so great? What makes us so perfect, better than the disciples?" It was all with through trials and tribulations. What makes us so perfect or so special that all these thousands of Christians that's been persecuted through 2,000 years, but we're going to escape it because we're so wonderful? Can you answer me that? We're the most corrupt generation that has ever been. We are a sinful generation. And we struggle with it every day of our lives. You know why? Because you're going down the road and they got billboards of naked women on the billboards. Yep. You know, or men in their underwear. Television. I haven't had a TV since 2015. That's how long I've been fasting television. These phones. These phones are the most corrupt things there is. It's corrupt. And I just don't, I don't believe we are such a perfect, that we are such a perfect generation that God's going to say, "Oh, my special little babies. I'm going to take care of you." I don't think that's going to happen.
Come on.
I think God's going to say, "Y'all are a corrupt, vile, disgusting, wanting to throw y'all up." And I'm talking about even the preachers, the churches. The churches are so corrupt, it's unreal. I guarantee you, if you would take the salaries from these big evangelists, that's television evangelists. When the government takes their salary, they'll never preach again. They'll never have another word from God because they're doing it for the money. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 15. You know, my daddy was one. And it's sad for me to say this, but after he died, you see, I was kind of lazy when it comes to biblical stuff, because my daddy was like a computer. He knew the Bible. He come up the old school way. There wasn't computers. You had to study and read. My daddy's life was in his library studying. We accepted that as his children because that was his calling. My daddy didn't spend a lot of time with us. He was a loving father. He was very good to us. But his thing was God. He was a God man, and that's what it's all about. And you better hope that God don't come and say, "Give your son up," because he'd put you on the altar and sacrifice you. That's how serious he was. But saying that, I didn't really have to study. I just go ask him, and he'd give me the answer. Well, after he died, I didn't have that. Oh, I had to start studying. That was torture. But to say this, he had come to the conclusion that the catching up would be anywhere from the middle to the end. Well, when I started studying on my own, and I read Matthew 24, and when Christ himself said immediately after tribulation, immediately after that nailed that didn't only throw the brick in the hearse, that wrecked the whole hearse.
Yes, yes.
Because Christ himself is telling us when he's returning. It's no question. I don't see how these Bible scholars even got lost on that. Because it's so plain.
Yep. Preaching.
The Bible is a strange book. You can miss something all your life that's just as simple as can be.
Yeah.
Because I think we as humans are going to make it more than it really is.
That's it.
But it's not. It's really simple. The Bible is written on a sixth grade level. Revelation, like Miranda was saying during Sunday school, it's just repeating itself. Through the generations, it's repeating itself. If you look at the statue of Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar had the dream. I don't know if y'all ever caught this. He had the first dream. But then God gave Daniel the dream the rest of his life. And Daniel carried the dream on. But the dream that was carried on was just a history thing. Just like Matthew 24, it's just a history thing. If you read the whole chapter, it's a recap of what past, present, and future. Now let's go to 15, because we're talking about the trump. And in here, it tells you what trump. Go ahead and read, Danny. Verse 51.
Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye.
Now, this event is telling you the same event of 1 Thessalonians 4 and Matthew 29. It's the same event. It's the same event taking place. Understand that. Go ahead.
At the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory?
Amen. So understand that these three events are the same events that's taking place. So that's why I'm telling y'all, the Bible is not really that complicated, because it's a lot of repeat. It's a lot of repeat. And like I was telling y'all know I had preached this before. I preached it in different parts, but I wanted to put something together because through Sunday school or just y'all talking, somebody made the remark that the rapture's not real and this and that. The word rapture is not real, but the catching up is. And the event is. The event of Christ returning and all of us as died in Christ will be caught up to join him. And I want to show y'all why I came to the conclusion that Christ is going to return at Armageddon. Actually, Armageddon, everything is over with, the judgment of the nations, the great whore. I do believe, as of right now, the great whore is the United Kingdom, United Nations. When it breaks it down to a single city or place, I believe it's somewhere in America. I believe America is that city, whether it's New York or Washington, D.C., or whatever, as of right now. Now, I'm always open to the good Lord showing me something new, showing me something different. But we see that in 1 Thessalonians 4, that to catch it up is when Christ returns. We see in Matthew 29 that Christ himself is telling us, and I keep driving this home, man. This is Christ himself telling us that. I mean, if you deny this, I think you're blaspheming. Christ himself is telling us immediately after tribulation, that he goes and tells the events of his return in a cloud. And then he's telling you right here in 15 at the last trump. All the other trump, they were just talking about trumps. But right here it tells you at the last trump. Now, people that study the Bible knows there's seven trumps. So we know it's in the seventh trump season that Christ returns. And the judgment seat is judgment of nations is what it's called. The Battle of Armageddon is actually called the judgment of nations. It's the final judgment on mankind. And let's go to Revelations 11. You got it? Say old man or amen.
Amen.
Verse 15. Notice 15 plays a big role here in these scriptures. I don't know why. I ain't figured that one out yet. Go ahead and read it, Danny.
And the seventh angel sounded.
Okay, so we know now we're in the season of the seventh angel. You understand what season we're in. We're in that season. This is the judgment of God. Go ahead.
And there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And the 24 elders which sat before God on their seats fell upon their faces and worshiped God, saying, we give thanks, O Lord God Almighty, which art and wast and art to come, because thou hast taken to thee thy great power and hast reigned. And the nations were angry, and thy wrath is come, and the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and thou shouldest give reward unto the servants of the prophets and unto the saints, and them that fear thy name, small and great, and shouldest destroy them which destroy the earth. And the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there was seen in his temple the ark of his testament, and there were lightnings and voices and thunderings and an earthquake and great hail.
So it's telling you at the last trump, and the seventh trump we know is the last trump, and it's telling you right here that it's finished. And it's telling you that Christ has returned. He set judgment, and he's already judged the nations or in the process of doing it. And it's finished. It's over with. Let's go to 16. Yeah, Revelation. This is the vows, or the, I don't know if your Bible says vows or mine says vows, but some of these new versions I say bows, and this is going to show you that it's Armageddon, that it's over with. Let's go to verse 15 again. Yeah, Revelation 16, verse 15. Go ahead, Danny.
Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. He gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon. And the seventh angel poured out his vial into the air, and there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne, saying, it is done. And there were voices and thunders and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake, such as was not seen since men were upon the earth. So mighty an earthquake and so great. And the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell, and great Babylon came in remembrance before God to give unto her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. And every island fled away, and the mountains were not found. And there fell upon men a great hail out of heaven, every stone about the weight of a talent. And men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, for the plague thereof was exceeding great.
I didn't have this in my study, but go ahead and read some of 17.
And there came one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, Come up hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of the names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns.
Okay, that's good. Yeah. Yeah, so I was thinking everybody already knew that.
Not really. Not on the internet.
Yeah. Everybody comes to our Sunday school class knows that. So if you come to Heart of Worship Sunday school class, outdoor class, you know all this stuff. But yeah, Sue's talking about the internet people, and I forget I'm even on the internet, because if I think about it, I'll freak out. But just a recap, I gave y'all a warning. I showed y'all a warning in the Bible that if any word, and actually the old translation was any tittle or title, I think it's called, which means comma or period. Comma or period. Even if you move a comma or a period, you're going to be judged. So that's a pretty strict judgment. I can remember one time we was having a discussion with a guy that used to come here. And I don't remember what the discussion was, but when we figured out what he was doing, he was removing the comma in that sentence. Well, when you remove the comma or the period, whatever it was, it threw the whole thing off. And I realized then why the Bible had gave that warning. But the word is caught up. We do believe, I'm making this clear for the internet people, we do believe in the catching up, that Christ will return, and the dead in Christ will rise first, and anybody that's living for the Lord, that's still in their physical body, will be changed in the twinkling of an eye. They'll put on that incorruptible body, and they'll be caught up with the rest of everybody else. We do believe that. And I want to throw a wide net, because we don't all believe it's at the same time. Some of us believe that it's in the beginning. Not many of us, one or two of us believe that it's in the beginning. And we still love y'all. We're just hoping that y'all take these scriptures and read what Christ himself said immediately. 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 So, and we're not a church to dictate and force you to believe a certain way. We want you to believe what the Holy Spirit is showing you. Sue and I was going to join this denomination, one of the biggest ones in the country, but they all required, the conference required, that we teach the pre-trib rapture. But when they told me that, I ain't doing it. Yeah. I said I'd have to be teaching a lie, but I think it's a lie. So we backed out of it. But again, 1 Thessalonians, Paul was telling these people not to be discouraged, to have hope. If you believe in Christ rising from the dead, also believe that you will rise from the dead if you die in Christ. In Matthew 20, 29, he was saying, Christ himself was saying, immediately after tribulations, he's going to return, plain and simple. In 1 Corinthians 15, it says at the last trump. So we know it's the last trump. We know it's the seventh trump. Revelation 11 is telling you that the kingdom of God is over with. I mean, that the kingdom of this earth, and God is taking dominion over everything, and he's in charge, and he's going to rule forever. In Revelation 16, he's showing a picture of Armageddon. Armageddon is the judgment of the nations. It's when it all finally ends. And I do have some more scriptures, but we ain't going to cover them. It's Job 3. If y'all want to jot down Job 3, it talks more about the Valley of Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat was the king that fought battles in his valley. And the valley is still there today, and that's where it's going to be. You know, back in the day of war, when men really went to war, they didn't go to war with the cities, in the cities, and kill the women and babies. They didn't do what we see these people doing the other day. Went into Israel and killed all these babies and all this stuff. And we didn't see Israel bumming babies either. They went to this valley of Armageddon, Jehoshaphat, and that's where they done battle. It was a perfect place for to do battle. Everything was set up perfect. And so that's where they all went, done battle. And God has prepared it and planned it that the last battle is going to be there. It says that the blood will be as deep as a horse's bridle. That's pretty deep. The birds of prey will gather, because it's going to take them 7 years to eat the flesh and clean it up. God's going to use the birds, the eagles, the whatever, the buzzards or whatever, to clean it up. Now I'm going to tell y'all something I've seen in my lifetime, and y'all got to remember this. When Katrina came through, when these people would come through, and they'd check out a building, and they'd mark the wall. Well, the Bible says that's the same thing that was going to happen again. They would mark the walls. But it would take them 7 years to burn. They won't have to use firewood out of the woods. They'll just go to that battlefield and take debris and burn it for 7 years. So that's going to be a lot of debris there. Be a lot of scrap art. I'm already thinking about scrap art business. So, but I want y'all to realize that we need to stay focus on what the Word says, what God says, what the Bible says. And we need to be careful, because all denominations, my first study as a young person, I was probably a teenager. My first study in the Bible was denominations. I was curious why there were so many different denominations. And why so many people could be confused. So I studied Armstrong and all the people of that time, and studied the Catholics, studied the, you know, that's why I'm a full gospel, because I've studied all these people. And my conclusion is this: every denomination has a sell point. For the Baptists, it's once saved, always saved. That's their sell point. It's not scripture. It's not in the Bible. For the Pentecostal, it's more about speaking in tongues than about Christ. They promote speaking in tongues, speaking in tongues, speaking in tongues, and not that much about Christ himself. The Catholics, I guess I walk on their toes too. The Catholics is Mary. It's more about Mary than Christ. Notice how it's always more about something else than the main purpose, Christ. And Even the Methodists. Sanctification. Sanctification was a big thing with the Methodists. We believe in salvation, we believe in repentance and all that, but it was that sanctification. So every selling point in a denomination has a selling point. And with the Methodists, I can say that sanctification was, it was there. But at the same time, they teach that once you were sanctified, you wouldn't become unsanctified. And I don't believe that. I believe it, whatever you do, you can undo, because you got a free will. That's another one, the free will people.
Calvinists,
yes. So I'm preaching a sermon that my sermons are focused more to the end of my life, because I think my life is coming to an end. And I'll be honest with y'all, this sermon was hard to get out. I was up at 1:30 this morning riding around Brian's house, looking at his Christmas decorations. I'm up half the night just riding around because I can't sleep, because I'm smothering with fluid. So my service is focused towards the church, and what I hope the church was founded on remains for the next generation till Christ returns. My father started his church in 66 on the basis of holiness, and I hope it stays on holiness. I could have turned this church over to people that didn't preach holiness. They were here, they wanted it, but I wouldn't do it. I'd rather see it close than go to a denomination that didn't believe in holiness and preach holiness. So my goal is for the sermons that I do from here on out is to keep us focused on what this church was founded on. Now, we were founded on holiness, the virgin birth, the crucifixion of Christ for the remission of our sins. And y'all need to stick to that no matter what, because they will be coming after y'all. And like I told y'all one time before, our downfall, I can tell you already, will be these cameras. It's just a matter of time that somebody's going to be offended. But we can't stop. We got to do what we got to do. We got to do what God called us to do.
Thank you for joining us today. This program was brought to you by HOWC Media Ministries. For more messages like this or information about our ministry, please visit us online at heartofworshipchurch.com.